The moment that hope was born, and guilt was pardoned once and for all, and captivated. Gonna ask you to stand as we move into verse 8, 9, 10, and 11, as we read from God's holy, infallible word. The scripture reads in verse 8, chapter 2, to the angel of the church in Smyrna, write, these are the words of him who is the first and the last, who died and came to life again. I know your afflictions and your poverty, yet you are rich. I know the slander of those who say they are Jews and are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. Do not be afraid of what you are about to suffer. I tell you, the devil will put some of you in prison to test you, and you will suffer persecution for 10 days. Be faithful, even to the point of death, and I will give you the crown of life. And once again, he who has ears, or has an ear, at least one ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And he who overcomes will not be hurt at all by the second death. I have There's so much here, believe it or not. In a whopping three verses, there's a lot to cover. And so I was going to compare the two churches, of the next two churches, but I thought I'd compare the first one with the second one. The first one is a good church. They're doing good things, but they're not motivated by love. So Jesus calls them to repent. The second church, he says, to the angel of the church of Smyrna, write, these are the words of him who is the first and the last. My goodness. I'll go back to the first church. He said, these are the words of him, in chapter 2, verse 1. These are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands. Okay, and then we have a different introduction. He said, these are the words of him who is the first and the last. That's interesting that he would take this title or this introduction and say the first and the last. As we read on, he says, who died and came to life. So this church, again, is caught between a rock and a hard place. Jewish culture, Roman authority, and they're stuck in the middle in their little bitty church. And Jesus says to them, he said, these are the words of the first and the last who died and came to life again. That's important for a church that's suffering persecution. I hear churches today, oh, we're suffering for the glory of God. What are you doing for the glory of God? Sharing with the same 20, 30 people that come to church every Sunday? Or are we reaching out and trying to win the lost to Christ? What are we doing for the glory of God? What are we doing? Persecution sets in when there's opposition to what you're doing. Amen. We don't get persecuted for sitting on our hands, sitting on our keisters and leaving here on Sunday and going home and watching the football game. We don't get persecuted for that. Right. Oh, I'm lost a job because I was reading my Bible. Man, it's not even begin to feel persecution. It's not what he's talking about here. He's talking about going to prison and even death. Isn't that what the passage just said? We don't experience that kind of persecution. We're worried about getting teased and made fun of for being a Jesus freak. Who's wearing a Jesus freak shirt in here? Stand up. Stand up. Look at that. I got three freaks over here. Come on, stand up, Raj. Praise God. Stand up, Melanie. Good, her hoodie says, not ashamed. She's not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Amen. Amen? Thank you. You can sit down. We're not ashamed, and we shouldn't be ashamed. We haven't even begun to experience persecution, folks. We haven't. Oh, I'm being persecuted. Really? What are you doing that would cause people to persecute you? And your persecution is the loss of a job? That's, I don't mean to minimize that, because that's significant. We have bills to pay. I understand that. But all I'm saying is that's a tip of the iceberg. It gets so much worse than that. So here Jesus says, the one who's died and came to life again. He's giving them hope. He says, these are the words that are coming from the one who died and has come to life again. These are the words from the beginning and from the end, from the beginning and the end, from the first and the last. These are the words from the Almighty. He says, I know your afflictions, your poverty, yet you are rich. How in the world could he say that? I have a couple of passages here. Somebody have 2 Corinthians 11, verse 14 through 15. Read that for me.
And no wonder, for Satan himself masquerades as an angel of light. It is not surprising then if his servants masquerade as servants of righteousness, their end will be what their actions
are. I'm looking at this passage that says, I know your afflictions, your poverty, you are rich. I know the slander of those who say they are Jews and they are not, but are a synagogue of Satan. Now that's a pretty harsh rebuke. I would be very careful, folks. Very careful to point out a religion and say, hey, they're a synagogue of Satan. Or that's a temple of the devil. Be very careful. Unless they got a pentagram and they're doing all this crazy stuff, and it's obvious. But I would just an example here. Please don't be offended. But like the Catholic Church, for example, if you don't agree with their doctrine, be very careful before you call them the Church of the Devil. Okay, but this comes from the Lord Himself. He says these people say they're Jews. They say they're, let's take the word Jew out and insert Christian. They say they're Christians. They say they love God. But they're a synagogue of Satan. He knows their motives. He says, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his hands. He walks among the lampstands. Jesus knows what he's talking about. He's not guessing and shooting from the hip. He says, this is a synagogue of Satan. You have to ask yourself, why do we do what we do? My goodness, when I read that, I thought, man, I don't even feel comfortable saying that. A synagogue of Satan. But and he says, I know this. Jesus says, I'm not asleep. I'm not on vacation. I know your afflictions. And in your poverty, this church was suffering. Yet you are rich. How can he say that? They're rich. They're rich. They're rich spiritually. They're rich in mercy. They're rich in love. He says, I know the slander of those who are talking about you. He says, they pretend to be Christians. They pretend to be churches of God, but they're not. And no wonder, for Satan himself masquerades as an angel of light. Verse 10, do not be afraid of what you are about to suffer. Now, interesting enough, he says, do not be afraid from what you are about to suffer. But he already said they're suffering. You know what he says? It's getting worse. It's going to get worse. He says, but don't be afraid. Well, how can he say that? Well, because he's the beginning and the end. He's the first and the last. He's the one who died and has come back to life. Jesus Christ is the Alpha and the Omega. He was in the beginning in Genesis. The Bible says that by him all things were made, and without him nothing was made. Everything was made by him and for him. And guess what? There's going to come a day where he's going to come. He's going to return, and he's going to judge all of mankind. So he's the beginning, and he's the end. Yes. And all throughout the scriptures, all 66 books, we have a scarlet thread of Jesus Christ. You can see him. He's there. If you look for him. But he's telling them, don't be afraid of what's to come. The suffering. He says, you think you're suffering now. It's going to get worse. But don't be afraid. Do not be afraid. He says, you will suffer persecution for 10 days. People are like, I don't understand the whole 10 days thing. Figuratively. Figuratively speaking, the 10 days. You know, how many we say, man, it's been raining. This we went camping the last 3 days. You know how long it rained? It rained all 3 days, didn't it? It did. But you know, if I said it rained for 3 days, you would think it rained for 3 days without stopping. But that's not true, is it? No, it's not true. It rained off and on, but it rained. So this persecution for 10 days is a fixed number of a fixed time. It's going to start. It's going to stop. It's going to begin. It's going to end. Persecution is going to happen. It's for sure. But it's going to be for a little while. And God is sovereign and always in control. He's talking to this church in Smyrna that's already suffering and telling them more is to come. But don't be afraid. It's going to start. There'll come a time when it stops. I will be in control. Church, I'm telling you something. We haven't begun to see persecution here. We haven't. And if we're not faithful now, when everything's fine, we won't be faithful then. A friend of mine is a pastor. He went to China. I shared this story before. To go share the gospel. He's going to teach people there how to share the gospel. And I said, awesome, that would be cool, man. I should go with you one of these times. He said, yeah, next time I go, I'll take you with me. I'm thinking, awesome. Then he proceeds to tell me a story about how they have to hide when he teaches these lessons. They're not at the university. They're not even in a church like this. They're hiding in somebody's dim-lit basement with candles. I said, really? He said, yeah. He said, well, if they catch me, they'll just, you know, make me leave the country. He says, but they'll kill the Chinese. I said, really? He said, yeah. He says, next time I'm going is like next year or whatever. And I said, I'll change my mind. I'm like, I'll pray for you. Maybe I'll get you a stack of those Gideon Bibles and we'll send them out. We're going to hold an all-night prayer service for you. We're going to pray for you guys. But I don't know if I want to go to China. I'm just being honest. We have the freedom here. And we're worried about losing jobs, being made fun of. I mean, really? That's not persecution. Persecution hasn't even begun in this great country we live in. I believe we'll see it in our lifetime. I do. But he tells them, do not be afraid of what you are about to suffer. I tell you, the devil would put some of you in prison to test you. This is important. and you will suffer persecution for 10 days. People say God is tempting me. The scripture says that God's not the tempter. Amen? Amen. He's not. God doesn't tempt. Temptation comes from Satan. 2 Corinthians 6:4 through James. Who's got James? I gave James. Go ahead and read it, Rob.
Chapter 1, verses 12. God blesses the people who patiently endure testimony. Afterward, they will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him. And remember, no one who wants to do wrong should ever say, God is tempting. God is never tempted to do wrong. And he never tempts anyone else either. Temptation comes from the lure of our own evil desires. These evil desires lead to evil actions, and evil actions lead to death. So don't be misled, my dear brothers and sisters.
Evil actions come from within a person. A person is tempted and led away by Satan himself. Satan can't make you do squat. He can't. He can whisper in your ear, he can tease you, he can tempt you, he can do it, he can nudge you, he can push you, he can kick you in the seat of your pants, but he can't make you do it. The Bible says you resist the devil and he'll flee from you. Amen? Okay, so Satan has no control over you. God will not infringe on our free will. You think he's going to let Satan do it? Seriously? He's not. We are tempted when we're led away by our own evil desires. And so Satan causes these things to manifest themselves in people, and people cause all kinds of trials and tribulations. They're the ones who cause the suffering of the saints. It is the people. It is not God. God allows it, because look what it says. It says, be faithful even to the point of death, and I will give you the crown of life. Let me tell you what faithfulness brings. First of all, I had a time in my life as a Christian. Oh boy, I hate saying this. I don't even like bringing it up, because I remember telling a friend of mine when I was going through a mentoring class, I said, I don't feel that I've ever been tested in my faith. Boy, do I regret uttering those words. Because shortly thereafter, the Lord allowed my life to be turned upside down. Did he do it? No. He used a series of circumstances allowing other people's choices to affect that. But you know what happened to me? My faith was tested. And you know who it surprised? Me. I said that I would be faithful. I didn't know that I would be. I shared a story about the car crash that I had where I really thought that I was going to die. On the side of the road, I'm gasping for air. I can't breathe. I think my lungs are punctured. They're probably going to collapse. And I'm thinking I'm going to glory, and so be it. And I was totally fine with that. I had a conversation with Brother Dennis just when he was in the hospital. He said, you know, I felt like I was facing my own mortality. And you know what? He says, I was fine with that. You'll never know what you know until you know.
Amen.
You can sit here today all day long and say, oh, I will die for Jesus Christ. But when the opportunity comes, you might surprise yourself. Okay, so we can profess one thing. The testing of our faith proves it. It proves it to us. It's refined in the fire. But you know what it does? It is an awesome witness. Man, I have this, I have a book that I was reading about the martyrs. It's an incredible book. I don't have time to get into that. But I'll share this story with you. There was a woman that I went to visit in the hospital. She was dying. And I went to see her, and her family was there. I went to encourage her and her family, and they were all broken and crying and weeping, and they were hurting. And I remember going in there thinking, man, I don't know what I'm going to say to this woman. I really didn't know her. She was the mother of a friend of my sister's. I never met the woman, never met the family. I walk in there, and this lady's laying in bed, and she says, this is what she tells me, thank you for coming, Pastor. Please pray for my family. And I look at her, I said, all right. And then she says, I know where I'm going. She says, I won't make it through the week. She says, I don't think. She's talking to her husband, don't forget the will. Don't forget. She's telling them, dot the I's and cross the T's. And I'm sitting here like this. Can't believe what I'm seeing and hearing. She was faithful. She says, I'm a Christian. I know the Lord Jesus Christ. And when I slip behind that curtain of eternity, I know where I'm going. And I'm not afraid. She said, in fact, I'm ready to go. And she wasn't kidding. And you know what? Next few days, she was gone. Her family was crushed and hurting. And she went out like a champ. Let me tell you, you know what she did? You know what her faith did for me? It ministered to me. As a minister of the gospel of Jesus Christ, this lady, this dying lady, ministered to me. Because she put her money where her mouth was. When it's time, it's time. And so he says, be faithful even to the point of death, because There's eternal implications. If you stay faithful, people are going to be influenced. They're going to be impacted by your testimony. How do you die? That's a good question. Do you die like a sinner with no hope? Or do you die like a saint who's been forgiven? He says, be faithful even to the point of death, and I will give you the crown of life. He who has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says to the churches. And he who overcomes will not be hurt at all by the second death. This crown of life, the Bible talks about the bema seat of Christ, how we're going to stand before the Lord. And we're going to receive those rewards in heaven. There's a real heaven, and there's a real hell. And he's telling the church people, well, hell is here on earth. It's not. You haven't seen nothing yet.
Nope.
In the book, as we get deeper into the book of Revelation, you will see as the church gets raptured, all hell is going to break loose then. And it still ain't hell. Amen? Because that time will be for a time, and it will end. The scripture teaches of a hell, a real, literal hell, that's eternal. And here, the passage we're reading, he says, be patient, be strong, stay faithful. And this is a church that's experiencing persecution from a culture, a Roman culture, and the Jewish culture, and it's collapsing on them. Church, we're in the same spot today. We are. If you don't think so, you must be sleeping. We're in a similar place today where the religions of the world are closing in on us. They're caving in on our sides. They are. And we're standing around with our mouth shut doing nothing about it. And the government on the other side is pushing too. It's like a pop can. You're pushing and pushing. I remember when I was a kid, we used to crush cans. Me and my sister. I said, I love my sister. She saved my life. Literally. I stand on this pop can. In the old days, they were pretty tough cans. They were tin. And we stand and we try to slap the sides. I could stand on it, and the can wouldn't crush. And she'd poke the sides, and it would collapse. That picture is what's happening to our church today. There's pressure coming in from the side. There's pressure coming in from the side. And there's weight on top of us. And if we don't stay, I'm telling you, if we don't stand firm, we're going to be smashed. Jesus Christ says, it is he who removes the lampstand. He blows out the flame. Have we done what we've been called to do? Are we burning bright like we're supposed to? Are we the witness that we've been called to be? Are we supporting those missionaries that are on the field that are sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ in all these different languages and all these different countries like the Gideons? Do we even care? I hear Christians all the time saying, my ticket's punched, I'm going to heaven. Literally, what they're saying is everyone else can go to hell for all they care. That's what they're saying. Let's not be that church. Amen? Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, Lord. Father, thank you for this day, O God. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your mercy. And thank you for your grace. Father, I thank you for this time you've given us together this morning, Lord. Father, I pray, O God, that you would just be with us, Lord, those of us who are here this morning and have received your word. Father, those of us who have an ear to hear, may we hear and receive what you have for us this morning. Father, I pray that you would move us, Lord, to be that church that is faithful, regardless of the persecution and regardless of the problems that may come our way. Father, as I truly believe in the life of our church in our lifetime, Lord, it will progressively get worse. Father, will you give us the strength and the courage to stand upright before you, Lord? Father, we praise you and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.